Okay. Thank you very much for introducing me. And first of all, let me acknowledge the jury committee for selecting me for such a prestigious award. And thanks to all of you for attending this session. So, topic that I'm going to talk about is size effect in asphalt mixture at low temperature. And my presentation will be divided in 5 sections. The first one on strength distribution, I'll introduce some background. I will then talk about the evolution of a size effect type in asphalt mixture. Then I will devote a few slides on stress singularity, the shape and on stress singularity. And I will try to see what are the benefits or the drawback for using size effect for pavement design. And finally, I will conclude. So let's start with some background. What we want to do generally in civil engineering, in general, when we design structure, is that we want to have structure the face or barrier of failure. And this is because we want to save money on one side, and for civil engineering structure, we want also to save lives. We don't want to have any loss of life. But to obtain such a low failure probability for the material that we use in civil engineering or in general construction, we cannot just rely on testing, and for this reason, we need to find some method that allows us to reach an estimation of such a failure probability. Therefore, we want to rely on probabilistic models. Specifically, we may want to rely on multi-distribution function, and when we deal with strength of material, we want to rely on CDL, so the multi-distribution function of strength. We may identify different types of behavioral materials. For ductile structure, we may work with the Gaussian distribution, which is very simple. And for the other extreme, we may have to work with perfectly data structure. In this case, we can use the Weber distribution and represent the structure as an infinite element or a chain of elements and use the infinite biggest model. When we have these two cases, we can work with two distributions, and it is very easy to obtain the parameter of the distribution. There are two parameter distribution, and therefore we can run a limited number of tests and obtain the parameters. But if we are working with different materials, which are quasi-plate materials, then this is no longer valid. And these materials are brittle heterogeneous materials that include concrete, fiber composite, for example, dental ceramics, and also asphalt mixture at low temperature. And for this material, we have that material homogeneities are non-negligible compared to the structure size. For specific type of structure, on top of it, for structure quality geometry, we have that a peak load, when the peak load is reached, as a macro-calcium shape from representing volume element, we have that we can use a different type of representation. We can represent the material as a fine chain of element or representative volume element, and then use the joint probability theorem to determine the failure probability of the entire structure, which is given by the contribution of the failure probability of the single representative volume element. This theory was developed over the years by Professor Basanti and his co-workers at the Northwestern University in the US. Based on that, the faculty developed this theory and determined what is the failure probability of each single RBE, and they obtained a simplified representation which returned a simple system equation and based on the hierarchical model part of the chain, in which the failure probability of representative volume element of quasi-plate materials is given by a fiber tail plus a Gaussian product. And for this, we have 4 parameters representing this distribution: mean standard deviation for the Gaussian curve, vacuum modulus, and scale parameter for the distribution of the tail. Based on the simple theory, we can get the actual failure distribution of the entire structure, and based on that, we can integrate over the stress and obtain the mean structural strength of the structure. Depending on the variation of the structure or the strength of the structure based on the structure size. Unfortunately, this expression, although it's simple, doesn't have a closed formulation, and therefore, the same group, Professor Bazant, came up with a very simplified expression which gives the evolution of the strength over the structure size for structure consisting of plane structure, so structure is in no temperature. So let's move into the use of this theory for asphalt mixture. And why do I want to use this theory for asphalt mixture? Asphalt mixture is a very structurally susceptible material, and these materials tend to become more and more brittle as the temperature decreases. So you move into sort of glass state, right, for very low temperature. This is because it's constituted by aggregates and asphalt binder, and therefore it's a composite material. The idea is that if I can attain better understanding of this material at low temperature in terms of strength and fracture properties, then I should be able to come into the practical outcome and be able to improve the durability of the pavement and potentially reduce and mitigate this phenomenon which is known as thermal cracking. As you can see, this is a picture that I took in my campus at Braunschweig, and you can see this series of crack on the pavement, this series of parallel crack, representing thermal cracking. This crack is not only serious because it is uncomfortable when you ride the pavement, but it's also dangerous in terms of the pavement structural state, as it may involve the penetration of water in the pavement and then further damage, and eventually cost. However, the research that was done in asphalt mixture on side effect is very, very limited. I did some research in the past, and this research, as I said, is very limited and is only addressing the limited crisis, the series of cases. However, we have different types of side effects. Mainly two. One is type 1 side effect that is valid for undamaged structure, and type 2 side effect which presents a completely different trend that you said the structure presents a notch or a crack or a pre-stress structure. On the top of which, when we work on the asphalt mixture and want to determine the strength at low temperature, we use specimens that are on single side, and therefore we don't take into account side effect. As I said, there is limited research. This limited research was involving a limited type of geometries. 3-point bending, in my case, my research. Disc shape contact tension test, so cylindrical specimen. This is very similar to the test we have to steal. And it was addressing type 2 side effect. And there is only, and there was only one case addressing type 1 type 2 side effect, but only from an instrument test point of view. And this is on semi-circular bending test. So as you can see, there are a number of limitations on the research that was performed on side effect in asphalt mixture. And either lacking in terms of type of side effect analysis or relying on assumptions that were not verified. So the idea that I had was to investigate size effect, try to incorporate type 1 type 2 size effect, and possibly have an experimental idea on how this type of size effect evolved from type 1 to type 2. And I did that working on 3-point bending test on different sizes, for different sizes, for different notch depth, with histogram testing, with mean size effect strength test, and size effect theory. So this is basically the research approach. For undamaged beam, I work on this type 1 side effect. For damaged beam, so for beam in the case preventing a deep notch, I work with type 2 side effect. And then I try to get an idea of what happened for beams presenting a shallow notch. For type 1 side effect, I use the type 1 side effect flow, the simplified expression, together with the histogram theory, so, and the probability distribution function. And for type 2 size effect, I work with a simple expression of type 2 size effect, which retards the evolution of the strength over the side from an horizontal plateau, horizontal line for small sizes, down to an asymptote that is following the linear elastic fracture mechanics for larger sizes. You can write this expression in different ways. Experimentally, what I did is select a very typical asphalt mixture that you use in Europe, basically in Germany, as I work in Germany. So asphalt concrete that has a nominal maximum aggregate size of 11 mm. It's a very common binder. We are characterized according to the performance grade that is used in the US. I perform a test in very low temperatures, around 92 degrees. I determine the RBE according to literature, and I work with a two-dimensional scale. These are the series of specimens that I prepared with more than 100 specimens. So for a series of specimens, for the smaller size, I used more specimens, I prepared more specimens because it was easy to prepare. And for the larger size, I reduced the number. Here is how we prepare the specimen. basically prepares slabs of asphalt mixture. Asphalt mixture is not like concrete. You cannot put the mixture and then obtain the shape that you want. You need to compact to a certain density. And from this set, you cut the specimen. So, four size specimen, and we introduce notches in the specimen of different depth. We perform tests in CMOD control, back mounted in displacement control, and depending on the presence of the notch or not, and the type of notch shallowness, I use a different type of setup to catch the crack, especially in the case of specimen presenting any notch, so for the dates. What you observe after the first test, looking at the evolution of the nominal stress as function of the relative CMOD, is that we have decreasing strength as we move from smaller structure to larger structure, and we have an effect of, I would say, of squeezing of the cost peak toward the y-axis as we move from the smaller structure and from the larger structure, showing that we are somehow catching the difference in the evolution of the strength and also in the evolution of the energy. And you can see this especially in the case of the larger specimen sizes, and especially in the case of the specimen sizes and either shallow notch or clay or no notch, for which you, there is a sort of moderate snapback. You can envision moderate snapback. After that, what I did was to plot the strength result in the vital plane in the simple midpoint position method. You can choose whatever method to plot this in the vital plane. And what I have is that the sort of parallel trend, especially in the lower part of the vital plane, where I can catch and identify the vital modulus of the mixture. Which means that the vital modulus appears to be for this temperature, for this mixture, a parameter of the material, and it is identify this factor. These are the mean strength values that I obtained from the test. As you can see, that again, the strength decreases from the structure size, so as we move from smaller structure to larger structure, and as we move from plain build down to deep notch build. And here, as you can see, as you simply plot the mean strength result in a plane where you have the strength on y-axis and the star and the scaling size of the thickness of the beam on the x-axis. After that, I apply the aquarium size effect, specifically discretized the beam, and I apply the weakest link model, and after that, I obtain the actual fitted histogram. As you can see, they fit pretty nicely the experimental result. As you can see, the vital modulus, which is that number 26 on the left of the plot, it's a very close value to what we observed in cotton strength pumping, commonly 24. And by using the weakest link model and the simplified structure, like one size effect, you can have the evolution of size effect on strength size effect, asphalt mixture over the specimen size, for the experimental data and for the prediction of different other sizes. And as you can see, for larger size, asphalt mixture appears to follow a value distribution. So we end up with the inclined line. After that, I fit the model of type 2 size effect to the experimental result. This was pretty easy. And as you can see, the model is catching very well the experimental result. We are somewhere between the two asymptotes, the horizontal asymptote for smaller sizes, and the asymptote that is leading to large size for the linear elastic function mechanism. And this is true for both notch specimen and notch specimen. I also did some more computation. I'm looking at the initial fracture energy and to the material characteristic then, because I want to have some information on the fracture process zone with respect to the RBA signs. This CF, which is the characteristic that gives me an idea on the, is related to the fracture process zone because it's at roughly half the fracture process zone, and this can last between 20.5, which is almost double of the maximum RBA size that was 11 millimeters from the mixture, and is roughly 5 times the size of RBA, the size N of 0, which you compute the RBA size. After that, I computed the dotted fracture energy with simple expression. And what is interesting is that I found that the ratio between the dotted fracture energy and the initial fracture energy is very close to what you observed in the past for concrete. This is enough because I compare also with the only study that was performed previously on Asphalt Mixture, and this is not consistent with what was done for that mixture. And this is probably mixture related, temperature related, and this gives an idea that this is something that needs to be further investigated. Here is a global representation of what I have in terms of size effect for type 1, type 2 size effect, the intermediate trend for the shadow notch beam with respect to the specimen size and to the notch depth. Both plots are pretty consistent with what we can observe in Fortran cement concrete with a recent study from Professor Lausanne, and suggest that there is a really significant jump when you move from undamaged condition to damaged condition. Here is what you see if you represent this in a three-dimensional plane. So there is a smooth transition to the top of it, not only a new sample, but a smooth transition for type 1 cell to type 2 transition. I also performed a very small investigation on stress singularity, so not only addressing stress singularity via straight notch, but also stress singularity via differential. So the idea here was to introduce a different stress singularity, so a V-notch shape to the beam. Working again with triple embedding tests and with a sort of generalized side effect model. So you can obtain that by using the type 1 side effect model, introducing the concept of the different shape of the singularity into the type 2 size effect by considering the angle of the notch that I'm introducing into the specimen. And you get that in terms of failure probability if you express the failure probability as a contribution. Failure probability associated with the part of the beams that are affected by the notch, the new notch, and the part of the beams that are affected by this notch. This requires some assumption. Here are the specimen that I prepared. I just worked with skin strength, and I introduced a specimen with a B notch of 130 degrees, and with a depth of 0, so 20%, very conventional. Here is what now it looks like, and the testing machine. So again, we performed the testing in CMOD control. And here are the results. I have very limited number of specimens. Again, we see this evolution of the strength over size and with a different over angle. And this is what happened when you fit the generalized string model to the experimental result. You have very quick type 1 size effect on the top of the plot and very conflicting for type 2 size effect. But if you look at the result obtained for a 120 degrees V notch specimen, you see that it is relatively close, but if you think that we are working in log scale, we are not so close. But what is even more interesting is that if you visualize this in a three-dimensional way, so there are a couple of snapshots. And if you compare with the plot that I was showing before, you see that there is a sudden and steep jump and the crazy strength when you start introducing a V-notch. This is not consistent with some of the work that was done on numerically, actually, where if you introduce a V-notch, you realize that there is again a smooth transition. So the question here is, if Asphalt Mixture is really behaving in a different way, so is there a completely different mechanism introduced when you place a V-notch into the specimen? Or if we did something wrong when preparing the Asphalt How I make a jump here, I will not discuss the model that are working correctly, but I want to show you something that may be interesting in terms of payment design. So I want to give you sort of a practical outcome of what may happen if we produce size effect in payment design compared to what we do correctly. So Asphalt layers are multi-layer system. So we have a series of layers of material that are based on constructed with a payment structure. So we start from the surface layer, binder layer, base layer, sub-base, and then sub-base. Where the surface layer, usually sometimes found the bias layer, we may have material consistent or asphalt mixture. So different characteristics of different quality. Before paving design, you need a lot of parameters, a number of information, including modeling, and you need also the strength of the material and low temperature. As I said before, the strength of material is obtained on specimens that have a single size. And therefore, we don't take into account when we paving design, we don't take into account size effect, what may be the evolution strength over the size. So what I decided to do is to try to introduce the value that may obtain from the size effect though into the pavement design and predict the service size of the pavement and compare to the current pavement. I use mechanistic paper pavement design guide according to the Asphalt software because this software is pretty well accepted in the US and in many other countries, for example in South Korea. And it's pretty much sophisticated, allowing a lot of flexibility. What I did is, since I didn't have access to the software, I asked someone to perform a simulation for me, and I provided information on the material, the asphalt mixture component. These are a series of parameters that you need. Without going into detail, I can show you a very simplified bar chart what happens if we design asphalt pavement with the current test method and when we start introducing size of pavement. So the red bar is what we want to achieve as a pavement service type by designing the pavement in the correct method based on this small specimen. And what happens if we introduce such effects, even for a damaged condition, is that we have a huge decrease in actual production service type, a decrease of 10 years. Which means that if we take into consideration what happens for a slight size, not a size, so for a size that may be comparable to what we have for a lane of a patient, so 6 meters. It occurs that we have decreased the service life of 10 years, and we actually, I believe we are more consistent in the design compared to what we did now, because I believe that we are overestimating the payment service life. So summarizing, the conclusion are that asphalt mixture follows either type 1, type 2 size effect, and when we introduce singularities, the type of side effect and is in intermediate and mixed mode, and this is depends on the type of singularity and the shape of the singularity, and then presence of size effect may be significant, then the use of size effect in the pavement design may significantly reduce the service life of the predicted service life of the pavement. With this, I want to acknowledge all the institutions, the people, the friends, professors,